Hi everyone, my name is Aakash. I work with Gojek. I work on products with Gojek. I've been there for the last 3.5 years. It's been a pretty amazing journey. What I want to share is some takeaways that I have from looking at this scale and extrapolating what kind of problems we generally get into when we are moving from pre-product market fit companies to post-product market fit companies.
Right.
Let's just take a look at the example of an Indian ecosystem. Maybe just this conference. About 5 years back when we had product conference, and I remember there used to be product plus design conferences at that time in time. Everyone would speak about analytics, A/B testing, funnels, cohorts, right? This is what all the talks used to be about. These are all extremely important pre-product market fit problems. So you have to solve them. Like, they are not simple problems at all. They are not easy problems. If anything, they're probably more difficult than the ones I'm going to talk about. Now, when you come to 2019, 100% of the talks that are being presented over here are actually very gritty, right? You can see they're coming out of experiences. You see they're coming out of a lot of pain. 50% of the talks are explicitly focused on dealing with growth, or you will find the keyword of 10x everywhere, whether it is used with engineering or product or scale, whatever it is. What this represents is a large number of Indian startups are at a higher rate moving from a pre-product market fit phase, transitioning into a post-product market fit. And these are very different challenges. The TLDR on pre-product market fit is you don't have a customer who is going to use you when, even if you try to push him away, right? Like, that's your pre-product market fit. Like, post-product market fit is where people just want to use it. You have already figured out the core value proposition, and now you're just getting some money, large amount of money, to throw at the problem and scale up the market. Right? You're in market acquisition. Now, this particular transition comes with a very specific set of challenges. When you are growing from this small company to large company, you are, of course, going to hire more people. In each of your teams, you will start setting up more skill sets required. You will geographically expand. You will start dealing with more complex market dynamics. What I mean by market dynamics is earlier you were focusing on just one customer segment, and now you will focus on maybe 3, 4, 5. There are more nuances to this. If you're trying to monetize, then you're not only focusing on that customer segment, you're looking at all the stakeholders that that customer deals with and then trying to create a more profitable ecosystem, right? A marketplace where you can make money at the end of the day. That's where the dynamics comes in. You will, of course, have broken communication. I mean, that goes without saying. If you are getting more number of people in more geographies with more skill, different skill sets in different teams, you are going to have miscommunication across the board. And a result of all of this is you're going to have massive misalignments. Very interestingly, Anshuman's talk just before that was on alignment. And I'm actually finding this very interesting because both the talks before, I can draw parallels into what I'm going to talk about. So I'm hoping to see that all the talks that happen today, tomorrow, are going to have these like interrelated references to each other. Now, everything that I'm going to talk about is out of my experience with Gojek in last 3, 4 years, and take that with a big pinch of salt, right? Because every company is unique, every company is a snowflake, and everybody so far has been repeating that message that take look at all of these as guidelines, whatever, mental models, but you figure out your own things. Now, a little bit about myself. Interestingly, Anuj and I share a slight bit of history that way. For most of my career, I have identified myself as a developer, 70% of my career. And I always wanted to be a developer. I aspired to be a better developer. I was following all the developer idols. But about 4 years back, I started moving away from just pure play engineering problems and just started getting interested in general problem that exists, right? Any problem is interesting at the end of the day. I did not realize that that's a journey that ultimately just makes me a product manager. I realized that's what a product manager is. You just look at a problem and you solve it. You don't really draw boundaries of which domain it is in. And through this particular transition, specifically for last 3 years, I got to see some very interesting patterns. Now, for those patterns, let me introduce Gojek. How many people over here have heard about Gojek and not on the sponsors board? raise your hand. Whoa, that's a pretty large number. Okay, I did not expect that. So Gojek started in 2015. I'll just give you a very, very brief overview so you understand the context I'm coming from. It started with three products. I mean, it's Gojek. You never really want to do anything slow, so the MVP is with three products, right? All the anti-patterns you will find in Gojek. We were doing roughly 500 orders, daily orders per day, three very, very bare-bone products. In about 4 months' time is when we started working with Gojek. So me is, I used to have a consulting company based out of Bangalore, and we used to help all growth stage startups solve their problems, and which is one of the reasons this topic is very interesting, because although I got to experiment with it a lot in Gojek, I've been thinking about it for a very long time. So this is when we started working with Gojek. By that time, they were already doing four products and they had grown 10x, right, which is insane. By October 2015, for a bunch of reasons, Gojek decided to acquire this a very tiny company of like around 12 people plus another company in Delhi. By that time, they had already two more products and had grown a total of 26x. So when you're growing at this rate, you're constantly going through re-architectures, not just at a code level, at your organization level as well. By January, similar to Anuj, although I joined on the engineering side, I started asking the painful questions, which had no answers. And then finally, I took over that, saying that, hey, let me head products. Right. So that's what my CEO asked me to do. I said, I'll try it out. Let's see how it goes. By that time, we had already had about seven products. In another 8 months, we had grown by 366 times more. That is 1.1 like daily orders with 12 products, which is like six more products added in those 8 months. By October 2017, which is like a year down the line all the way, we had grown 1,000x. Interestingly, valid number, but you know, has the perfect zeros in compared to when we started, actually started working with Gojek. So this journey has been phenomenal. By this time, also like one person as head of product made no sense. So I moved into more exploratory projects, doing different things, which is what I'm actually going to share with you today. This is the latest number, February 2018. We have about 22 plus products at this point. These are consumer-facing products, plus completely different stakeholders with merchants, drivers, our other applications. So it's a pretty complex ecosystem, and we're very much happy to get praise from someone like Shailendra. So just I'll let you let the slide do the talking. Anyway, in this process of, let's say, last 3 years, although I've seen different challenges and everything was quite painful, quite a lot of learning because of a lot of failures, I want to still limit to these four types of problems because I believe they are useful. Like the mental models that I have walked away with and some frameworks that I have walked away with might be useful for someone who is now getting into growth. Right. That's the TLDR. Now, in one of these exploratory projects that I was doing, one was the promotions platform. I'm assuming most of the guys are from Bangalore or surrounding areas. You surely have used Swiggy, Zomato. You see those discount vouchers, coupons coming to you, which are restaurant specific, right? Very likely Swiggy is paying just some part of that discount, not the whole. And the same we wanted to do, because if you are able to create this marketplace where customers are being given discounts by restaurants who are using these platforms as a customer acquisition or a customer retention channel, it's a win-win for everyone, right? Like that's the beauty of platform plays. You need to find those instances where the value of the platform is felt by everyone equally, and that is when you can be sustainable. So one of the hypotheses that I wanted to run is just see how this really works out. Now, I decided to go lean because in the last 1.5, 2 years, we had done a lot of chaotic development. I really wanted to go back to my basics. So we started with a core objective of just proving that there is a core value proposition over here. Right. What that meant is get repeat business from restaurants where restaurants are ready to pay for those discounts. Are restaurants ready to pay money? Do they see that value? Now, proving this did not really require us to get any developer. We had a bunch of building like components already in place, building blocks in place. So one PM, that was me, one analyst, and zero engineers. We basically manually ran campaigns for 5 weeks while constantly analyst optimizing for the selection criteria, because now I need to pinpoint you perfectly, right? I need to find the person who can afford that particular restaurant, who is in that particular area, is likely to order in that particular time period, and plus 30 other parameters that will affect. But doing that really did not require large scale development, right? So we decided that let's deal with one unknown at a time, that is figuring out how do we create this value. After 5 weeks, we were able to increase the number of orders placed at a restaurant by more than 15% consistently. So, and the restaurants were happy, they were ready to pay for it. The only problem was it took 7 days to run one campaign because it was manual, right? So we were literally using CSV uploads, CleverTap, some other push notification solutions, to just manually doing everything, because if we had come up with a large roadmap, that roadmap itself would have gotten into a few months. It was unnecessary. We didn't even know what, whether it will work in the market or not. Once we passed that particular threshold, we had excitement from the sales team. We had excitement from the management. I think, again, Anuj referred somewhere that you need to show, not tell. We basically decided to show the real results, right? That's the best way to convince someone. Just see, show revenue. After this, our metric that we picked up was to keep increasing the campaigns per week, because we knew that we had good enough accuracy at that point in time, for that time. But our campaigns per week was atrocious. Now, this is where we needed to scale the solution and we needed a developer. So we got two more devs on board, we added one analyst on board, and we carefully added one more sales to my team. This is not working with some salesperson. Again, I'm just gonna keep doing these shout outs. I think Anshuman mentioned something about cross-functional teams, extremely critical. Right, wherever you can, please build cross-functional teams. So now getting an analyst, developer, PM, and a salesperson to build this whole system, which keeps increasing the rate at which you can run campaigns, was the critical factor. We realized that in doing this, the reason it was taking that long, 7 days, is because of the workflows that analysts had to go through. So analysts were the bottleneck. Now, sure, I could magically go and find 100 analysts and add to the problem, but that's not going to work. So we decided to treat our analysts as the customers. So all that meant is my PM and developer, that's like me and developer, was working with this guy, looking at what he's doing, help him in his process, understand that particular process, cut out all the noise in the overall system, work with developers, because the data scale that we were working at was pretty massive. When you're doing it manually, it's still okay, but when you're trying to do it programmatically, the amount of data we were dealing with was pretty large. So we started in this particular setup, treating the analyst as the customer, and over a 2 months period, we were able to automate that whole system for the analyst, and we were able to get to 20 campaigns per week, which doesn't seem like a very large uptake for so much development done. But the problem was analysts were able to run one campaign is less than 30 minutes, and that 30 minutes itself was async. So his actual time was just 1 minute of submitting some form. That's all it was. The bottleneck had turned to the marketing team, because still our communication was happening manually, right? So that operation, marketing operations, is what was taking more and more time. So we said, sure, let's take marketing as the customer. So we observed what the marketing team was doing. We were ourselves running those campaigns, so we knew exactly what was being done for last 3 months. And we started automating each part of that particular system just enough. We were not necessarily removing all manual interaction altogether. Just look at the bottleneck and solve it. And during all this, because of the way systems were developed, analysts were still able to keep improving the accuracy of the algorithms that they had. This meant we were able to see another 10x growth in about 1.5 months' time, because the marketing part was not that crazy. We just had to create some templates and copies and so on and so forth. Although we had marketing as a role in my system now, right? The way you have customers, like your marketing was a role in my system. So we were able to easily do 200 campaigns per week. We were able to consistently show 30% growth in orders or revenue. They're almost synonymous, depending on the value of the voucher. And the ops time came down from 6 hours to 1 minute, which was nothing but click, click, click. Right? That's what it boiled down to. Now the bottleneck switched to sales. I'm pretty sure you guys can guess what we did next. Right? You look at the sales as customer. Again, same metric. Sales planning and approval was becoming the bottleneck. Now, what we mean by sales is we were expanding into 50 cities. And the planning and approval for each campaign, which was still being done centrally because of the audits that happened, because of the some quality controls that central management wants to keep, that was becoming the bottleneck. So all we had to do was just build a bunch of CRUD systems, which allowed those workflows to be automated and remove every manual intervention that we were able to remove. The analysts were still working on improving the algorithms because their workflow was completely independent. About 8 months down the road, when I developed this whole product and then handed it off to a team which is now taking it further, we were able to consistently show more than 50% growth for restaurants if they were willing to spend that marketing money. I mean, it's just like any other business. We had a fully automated end-to-end campaign management, and today about double-digit percentage of GoFood orders are merchant-funded. Right. Now, I have few... Sorry, the reason I'm telling you this particular story, which is not really a war story, is to highlight the fact that lean still works even at a unicorn. So just because you're moving from, you know, like this very lean company which didn't have too many people, didn't have a budget, and because of that you're doing everything by the book, and then now you get money, and now you're gonna throw all your money and people at the problems, you will still have a higher ROI by doing this. If we can do this at Gojek, you can do it at any company. You still need a lot of alignment, right? Again, going back to Anshuman's setup. You want to make sure that people have that faith in you, people give you that time to prove things, you are working with the right stakeholders. All of that is important. But lean works. The second takeaway, and this is the most important takeaway actually, is please treat your internal stakeholders as customers. I mean, I'm not saying something new, right? I'm sure like internal customer is used very, very frequently. Remember Anshuman was mentioning that getting empathy from about the person that you're working with, be it someone in finance, be it someone in sales, be it someone in marketing, operations, depending on the complexity of your company, the stakeholders will increase. It's actually quite frustrating. It is frustrating because you are treating them as someone who has the same context as you. And as a product manager, you have a superpower that most other people don't have. And that superpower is you are used to just assuming someone is a customer and you never call them stupid. You have infinite patience with them. You assume that you don't know anything about them. You study them. You document everything. You want to know more about their life than they know about their life, right? That's what you take pride in. Just do that for the internal stakeholders, and this is just a mental hack, not even giving you a new process. Just start truly calling them and acting as if they're internal customers. Your overall productivity of the team, your alignment problems, your overall delivery will go through the roof. I promise you that. Just want to call out the nuance. When do you differentiate between collaboration and, you know, calling a customer? If, let's say, I as a PM got those requirements from VP of sales as to I need blah, 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 that's collaboration, man. But if I'm actually on the ground with the salespeople going and making those sales calls, and we did that, I actually took my analyst with me to make the sales call, I took my developers to make the sales call, because specifically with the geographical distance of Gojek being in Indonesia primarily, the developers and analysts being in Bangalore, we had to excessively compensate for the, you know, the extra distance. So I took everyone over there and made sure that they felt like they were customers. So if you're taking your feedback on the ground and not from some manager who is not on the ground, sure, then they're your customers. The other one, I'm just going to extend it further, right? You should treat your company as the product and the internal stakeholders as the customer. What I mean by treating your company as the product is, your product is nothing but a problem definition, a problem scope with a fixed set of stakeholders that you have accepted. That's all that product is. I'm just saying that now start looking at your company in the same way. You have company level metrics anyway. you do think each role is doing some sort of a job. You are looking at the dynamics in between them. But just now start treating everyone as the customer and your company itself as a product that you're working on, that the challenges that are there that you're enjoying, you will sleep far happier. Right. Now this addresses both market dynamics and communication. Market dynamics because you are on the ground. So you have now as much context as anybody else and you're consciously making sure that you maintain that context. The communication part, again, because now, like, do you ever feel that as a product manager, it is acceptable that your communication with your customers is broken? You will not take it right. I mean, what's the difference between internal stakeholders? So if you go with the same attitude, you will have really great communication with everyone that you're dealing with. Moving on to the next point, I was looking for images on teamwork today. And I found this one, which is very interesting. It's the first image that I actually found. And this really represents the risk that I see maximum for any company which is going fast or which is moving fast. Teams not pulling in the same direction. And it is not easy. Your teams will pull in the different directions, right? What I mean by pulling in the different direction is if they have different context, if they have different aspirations, if they have communication gaps, everybody is trying to do the best they can with the information they have. Trying to pull everyone in the same direction just means that everybody has the same context, they have publicly made some decisions, are accountable for those. That's it. That's all it is. You still assume people to work exactly the way they work, but this becomes a first-class problem. Let's look at this at a very smaller level, right? Even if you just have 5-person team, you are still, and let's say that your PM versus TL versus designers are not on the same page about what they imagine as the future of this company or future of this particular product or just feature. You are going to have constant friction where they are disagreeing on implementation details because, you know, philosophically they are disagreeing. You will have each making their unilateral decisions, and unilateral decisions are important. I mean, they're doing decisions, small decisions in their life or in their day-to-day basis, but they are assuming a different feature. They are aspirational to a different feature. All of this is just going to cause frustration. And this is for a 3 or 4-person team. I have experienced it myself. I'm sure most of you would have as well, where you just say that, hey, I'm not able to talk to this person. That's what this means. Now, when you expand this at a team level, at a company level, it's like multiple orders of magnitude, larger problem with larger ramifications. So let's just look at a case study, like a use case, in a very similar setup, right? The whole promotions platform that I was working on. We basically identified that as we were moving through the larger and larger cities, the conversion rate started dropping. That is, for every 100 vouchers that we were distributing, how many vouchers were being used? And nothing had really changed in our system. So we like, hey, why is this really happening? So we just saw a trend. After a few hours of digging, we realized that we are getting restaurants onto the platform, which ideally even the customers don't want. So we are literally distributing vouchers of restaurants which are not probably great restaurants. Now, when we started drilling into this, it took a really long time, and in hindsight it seems unbelievable, but it took a really long time to go back to the crux of the issue, which was just the incentive set on the marketing ops level in those 50 cities. They were incentivized to do something else altogether because the way it was communicated to them in just a nuance that we want more vouchers, so get me more deals. And some guy who basically I had never spoken to, right? So it's my mistake as a product manager. Some guy that I had never spoken to who sets the incentives for these salespeople set what he thought were the right incentives. And that was going completely contra to what I as a product manager wanted to take my product to. All we had to do was first agree on why we are doing what we are doing, sort of goes back to the mission part probably, and then figure out what kind of activities and commitments from the product team and from the sales team are nurturing to each other rather than counterproductive, right? Once we went through this particular process, we were able to get really good conversions and we were able to grow quite substantially, right? So just the solutions was incentives against GMV. The SLA from the product team was conversion rate because they're like, hey, if my commission is going to be a function of the conversion, which is a function of your algorithm. I mean, how? I don't want to do that. So we had to basically sign some sort of SLA saying that, hey, your commission you will get only if the conversion rate for these campaigns is beyond this. But for me to promise you conversion rate, I need a certain quality of restaurants. So now we are telling salespeople that this is how I define the segment of the customers or the merchants in this case, and you can sell only to these people. And by both of us getting into nuances of why we wanted to do things differently, what were our concerns, what were our ambitions, this, you know, this just got solved. Like, since then, there has never been a problem. Now, fortunately, we were able to catch this in the early days of the platform because we had that particular metric and someone made the connection. But you will have such dissonances across the organization very frequently in large amounts. And those are very expensive. Those are one of the most expensive mistakes you can ever make. It's better for a company to execute in the wrong direction with a tight execution and go there and realize the mistake rather than everybody doing different things and never getting anywhere. It's a seriously expensive mistake. Now, when we think from a product perspective, and again, few terminology because I do come from a development background, the inception is very important, right? So when you're thinking about a five people product team, you do this inception because you want to make sure that everyone shares the big picture, everybody has buy-in on the backlog. You maintain the backlog so everybody knows what we are going to do, why we are going to do this, why the prioritization is this way, assuming we have a framework for prioritization. We have public dashboards where visibility around the status of various metrics is visible, right? That again reduces these issues. You have showcases, so you constantly showcase to your internal stakeholders or other customers as to what all things you are doing, what is complete, what is not complete, where the bottlenecks are, and you also want to create a cadence where there is a dialogue about this product and what the team feels. So the reason you follow these four practices, call them Agile, XP, whatever, is to create better communication and feedback loops within the teams. This is for a project. This is for a five-people team. Company is a team of teams with very different stakeholders, very different skill sets. So what is the inception, backlog, dashboard, showcase parallels for a team of a team, which is a very complex organization? It's from the same, wherever I copied that from. Imagine these four are actually four different departments. What you want is all of them to have a shared vision that they believe they are all in the same direction. You need to have a same language because trust me, the number of times you are going to use one word and the other person will assume a different meaning of that particular word is very common. So you better have something literally written down. We maintain a wiki where I define my glossary. What do I mean by blah? Because I'm 100% sure there will be at least 20% who will misunderstand. You want to have a shared context and all of these nuanced. Big picture, I'm sure everybody's there. And those nuances require constant dialogue, communication. What we need basically is tools, like maybe mental models or communication tools that help us bring this shared vision, context, accountability, so on and so forth. I'm not going to go into the details of exactly how we did it because what we used was actually OKR. Sorry, I want to really call this out. If you need the need to study product management, which trust me is like two orders of magnitude more simpler than managing a complex company, and I don't mean this from a, you know, like, oh, you did the MBA and then you're managing a company from accounting perspective, but the larger team is extremely difficult. So please study it. Don't assume that whatever you are doing when you are a five people company is going to work when you are a 50 people company. That is the part that will slow you down. So be very cognizant of this. We use OKRs. I'm not going to cover a lot of it. For me, it stands similar to what Lean and Agile is to product management. I look at it from a company management perspective. It's just a communication and information organization framework. You can do whatever you want within it. Okay, it's extremely flexible. It is not the solution. Absolutely not. It's just a tool. It is going to surface a bunch of problems that you have to solve. If you use this tool but not solve the misalignment that the tool is surfacing for you, I mean, your life is not going to get better, right? This is not the only solution, but a good one. I'm really looking forward to Rahul Malik's talk. I just read that someone is actually going to present on OKR, so let's see, you know, how different companies are doing it. I just published 2 seconds. I just published the OKR FAQ at this. You can search for it, or on Twitter you will find it. This is what I rolled out when we were doing the third iteration of OKR rollout at Gojek. The first two were very fuzzy and very wrong for multiple reasons. This is my best guess right now. Right, I'm pretty sure I'll update it in the coming future. And this really requires, this particular problem requires a lot of community discussions. So, I mean, please find me offline or engage me on Twitter. I'm more than happy to talk about it. And I'm extremely happy that all the talks are going in this direction. Okay, summary of everything that we went through. Thanks.